Cricket dash at that one, which is slightly overpitched. All these runs this evening, priceless for the West Indies, just to reduce that task tomorrow. One more run added to take it along to 68 for one at the close of play on the fourth evening. And the West Indies, a slight advantage there. Hooper out for 14. Campbell did very well. He went right through to the end for 14. Wasn't flurried at all when Lara came in and played so beautifully to make 38 not out in almost the same number of balls. 68 for one. The bowling figures for England. They weren't quite as much on the ball as in the first innings, but picked up that one wicket of Carl Hooper. Fraser, no wicket for 23. Goff, one for 27. Illingworth, three overs for eight. And Martin, the same figures, three overs for eight. So at the close of play on the fourth day, that is the situation. West Indies need 228 more runs to win. And
is introduced by Richie Beno.
Last time England defeated the West Indies at Lord's was way back in 1957.
Can you bowled him of his pad. England have won by an innings and 36 runs. And all the crowds and the small boys dashing onto the field.
England will be aware, though, of the dangers of the West Indian batsmen. In 1984 at Lord's, Gordon Greenidge made 214 as the West Indies successfully chased the massive target at 342. Today the target is another 228 runs for an overall total of 296. They don't have Greenidge, but they do have another Barbadian, Sherwin Campbell, and of course they have Brian Lara. Welcome to the highlights of the final day of this Cornhill Test match. We've had four great days so far. Scintillating cricket, good batting, good bowling and some brilliant fielding, and this is the way the final day began. That's the scorecard of the West Indies second inning, 68 for one. Hooper the man out for 14, he fell to Goff, caught by Martin at mid-off. Then Campbell unbeaten on 14, and Brian Lara, some lovely stroke play in that 38 not out. 68 for one, and the wicket taken there by Goff, six overs, no maiden, and one for 27. Just to bring you up to date with the match situation, coming into the last day, England 283 and 336 all out. West Indies 324. And 68 for one. They need another 228 more runs to win. Well, the pitch has been the subject of much comment in recent times, and here's Geoffrey Boycott out in the centre.
Well, spinners haven't played any part in this match so far. 31 wickets have fallen, and only two to spinners, if you can call Carl Hooper a spinner. I mean, these footmarks should come into play, particularly against the left-handers. Richard Illingworth should be able to bowl into the edges of these when Lara and Atherton are batting the left-handers. He could even bowl into them when the right-handers are batting, bowling at leg stump. But I still think the seamers will play the major part. Here we are, right down the middle of the pitch. If you can just look here, the wear and tear, those cracks have disintegrated on the edges. Here they are. There are bound to be a number of low balls, but all in all, the batsmen should still be able to play on it. The reason, the pitch has got slower and slower, so although the low balls appear, they can still make runs if they apply themselves.
A very interesting day's play coming up here, the fifth day of this test match, and we join it in the first over. It's the fourth ball. Darren Goff is the bowler. Brian Lara is taking strike, and three runs have been added to the overnight total.
Just short. That was so nearly the early wicket that England needed. Three slips there waiting to the edge. This one just dropping short of a third of them. Brian Lara did well, just didn't push out at it. Angus Fraser prepared now to open the attack from the nursery end. Bowling to Sherwin Campbell. Oh, that's going to be four. Now, runs should be precious to England this morning. But throughout whatever is needed of the day. By leaving the third man out of contention at this stage, anything like this guided away down there, especially when the ball bowling is from the nursery end, is going to run away very quickly for four. Oh, good stop. Nice piece of fielding. On the line of gully, but very deep. News from the England dressing room. Graham Thorpe, who's suffering from a throat infection this morning, might reappear if necessary after lunch. He's been given antibiotics. Nothing too serious. Well, there's plenty of space at square leg, and that's nicely timed too. Darren Gough has got nine of his fielders seven of his fielders on the offside. The 7-2 split this is. And Brian Lara very adept at this. It's a lovely shot. Just a turn of the wrists.
That was a really good shot. Short, back lift. Just firm, crisp follow through. Not the flourishing drives that we've sometimes seen him play. That was real control.
No need to run for that. Darren Gough has overpitched this morning. Too often. And that last one gives Brian Lara the chance to go to 50. Not out of 59 deliveries. Not this time. Anything up there is going to go like a rocket. Darren Gough doesn't have to stray by much. Brian Lara is going to capitalise.
He doesn't need to run a lot when he hits them like that.
Oh, beautifully taken. Great catch by Alex Stewart. That's the change that England needed. Two boundaries followed by the wicket of Brian Lara. So England have struck back. That was a great catch.
Well, it's a pretty good catch, this, from the opening batsman. Oh, top class. Good ball. Real great catch. That wouldn't have carried to first slip. It got right across. It never looked like missing it. Right smack in the middle of the glove.
All he could do was reach it with the left hand and caught it beautifully. So the most important wicket, as far as England will have seen it, has been taken. Good line from Darren Gough too. Just that hint of movement away. And the right length. So Jimmy Adams is left-hander replacing the left-hander. 99 for two, West Indies.
Another one, but beautifully shot. That's the sort of feeling you need at a crucial day, every run priceless. That's the sort of athleticism required, and desperation as well.
So he's now three slips a gully and the third man, which means he's decided that he's going to attack, but yet he has to defend at the same time.
Destroyed whatever Michael Atherton's theories might have been, is in the end a one-hand shot.
With extra man, a third man, it allows something of an extra space somewhere in the offside. It's just a mid-off, an extra cover. Therefore, you have a lot of space playing a shot like this.
That's a very good shot indeed. Plenty of power straight down the ground, and that'll be four runs.
Perhaps the timing was not as perfect as Jimmy Adams would have liked, but certainly hit it with the middle of the bat.
Caught him, second slip. Jimmy Adams goes, and that's a terrific blow for England. He's usually very cautious and strikes out only when he's certain that that cover drive did not come off. A thick outside edge went to Hick at second slip. 124 for three.
And highly uncharacteristic of Jimmy Adams, especially in these circumstances. A very, very wide ball. And the man at second slip, Hick, made no mistake. Adams stamped it into the drive. Very difficult for a man at second slip to drop something like that. That was straight in, just about the midriff. Dominic Cork strikes, and strikes well.
Incoming batsman is Richie Richardson. Oh, and that beats him beautifully bowled this time. It's a maiden over.
Few batsmen will actually touch that. That was too good for many, many people.
Wonderful stroke. And it's worth watching again his footwork. This is a man who's actually changed his style of play within the scope of these two first test matches. Impressive bowling by this England side, and especially by Dominic Cork. So Richie Richardson goes for naught, and it's 130 for four. In fact, he got his left foot in line with the ball, but his foot right across, absolutely in line with the ball, and that makes it very difficult. The bat has to come around the front pad. And you need to be in some time to play across the line like that. Keith Arthur.
132 for four West Indies in this second innings. Three wickets falling this morning. Lara, Adams and Richardson. And a very tense period of play now. A lot of runs scored for seven overs. And there comes that first run for a long, long time. It also brings up Sherwin Campbell's 50. Well, that's been a hard-fought 50 for Sherwin Campbell. Little man from Barbados. First appearance at Lord's in a test match. It's been very well played.
Got him. Inside edge on the pad, and umpire Shepherd signalling straight away that it's a catch, not LBW. And Dominic Cork has struck again. Paul Weeks, the subfielder, is the man in there at Shortford Square. And that is another blow for the West Indians, and a cruel one too. It's 138 for five. Atherton, 40 balls he faced, didn't get off the mark, and 49 minutes in all.
perfectly pitched leg cut it to the right-hander, coming back into the left-hander, and just touch. West Indies are in serious trouble at this stage.
It was an interesting gesture from umpire Shepherd. I haven't actually seen that before, but it's something the ICC have been working on, I suppose, a little along the lines of football refereeing, where they will let the people know exactly what is happening and what type of decision has been made and why it's been made. New batsman now, Junior Murray. Shot, that'll race your way down the hill towards the tavern. Going to get a game for Worcestershire United.
Peter Martin again, creating the mortal sin of bowling on the leg stump. He's only got three men there, the fine leg, the square leg, and the man wide at mid-wicket. This one's just going past the man at square leg. The man at fine leg couldn't stop it.
There's a good cricket from Campbell now, because he realises they're down to, well, not quite the tail. You're still with the all-rounders there, Murray and Gibson, but he is the one now who has to take charge. And he's not all that experienced, but that's clever cricket. Fine stroke. Just racing away down towards the pavilion, and a lovely boundary from a player who is showing terrific temperament out there.
We've seen two batsmen on the England team actually get out this way, and Darren Gough's reaction suggested that it must have been a touch there, but Stewart did not actually get it cleanly. Reaction seems a little bit of disappointment.
It's not a good line. Not a good piece of fielding either. Not only has Mike Atherton to be aware of what's likely to happen and keep himself right on top of things, but the responsibility on his bowlers and his fielders, I think his friends are a long way away from that. That's going to be four. Really is Junior Murray's stronger side, that. And although Darren Gough has a man at square leg and a man at a widest mid-on, really can't afford to stray too much towards leg stump like that. It was just drifting in a bit. Catch it. The shouts are going to have us a good catch. And he's out. Great piece of work at short leg. So the substitute fielder, Paul Weeks, takes another good catch. First one simple, this one's a far better catch. Had to move to his right. Again, just the inside edge, onto the pad. That's a very good catch.
Well, England have got the right man in the right position. Junior Murray just got himself tucked up there. Didn't seem to really want to play it with a straight bat.
Otis Gibson, the new batsman, playing in his first test match. Sheldon Campbell reduced to the role of spectator just for now, as Otis Gibson prepares to face his first ball from Darren Gough. That's got to be close. Just slipping down the leg side. the excitement of the moment taking the England fielders off their feet, the crowd off their feet, off their chairs. And that ball just swinging in.
Yes, it was just the late swing, as David mentioned, that saved him. But they're always looking to whip it through the onside. They don't seem to want to play anything straight.
Campbell had no idea just how close that ball was to his stumps. You'll have a look at the replay on the big scoreboard, on the big monitor at Lord's this year.
Woo. Yes, the ball seemed to get dragged round by his hands. It sort of hit the hip, and his hands seemed to drag it round. It was a swing into the leg and dropped over the top.
Going to be four straight down the ground. Again, there's a big element of risk in this shot. Feet have gone nowhere, it's just a swing of the bat.
Yes, Davey's right, it's all a matter of luck. There's no footwork at all, the feet just stand, they're stuck almost in concrete in the batting crease, and he just throws the bat at the ball.
Dominic Cork, I think, recognizing that things have been just too serene for a while, deciding that he's going to give Otis Gibson something to remind him that this is still a test match, he's still a fast bowler.
It's four runs, and that won't be to the liking of Michael Atherton, or to Dominic Cork for that matter. The two batsmen punched fists in the middle of the pitch. It's a while since they've done that. They might be just starting to look at the score again and think we can do this. LBW. Otis Gibson has gone to Cork. 198 now for seven, three wickets in hand for West Indies. Otis Gibson gone for 14. LBW to Dominic Cork, who's had two very good days here. Valuable partnership yesterday and wickets today. He's just playing down the wrong line there. He missed it by a good 2 or 3 inches, I'd reckon. Playing outside his pad, and the ball has gone straight through and struck him just below the knee roll. Ian Bishop is the new batsman. What two there for him? Pretty concentrating on twos or fours. Then the quick single will be fit for the sixth ball of the over. 200 up. Now it's still possible for the West Indies. 201 for seven, Campbell on 93. Wicket and Campbell 93. A brave innings and technically a magnificent one. A very, very good performance from Sherwin Campbell. There are a lot of people around the ground and watching on television. Very sorry he's got an inside edge there and hasn't gone on to make it. Stump vision gives a very good shot, and so does the close-up camera. Little inside edge and the ball carrying through to Alex Stewart. Disappointment there for
Sheldon Campbell, now Kirkley Ambrose. 94 needed or 2 wickets needed? There it is, it's straight down the ground shot. Never discard Kirtley with the bat. Don't discard him with the ball either. But I've seen him play some very, very annoying innings from the fielding side's point of view. He does that, then he blocks by numbers, then he'll hit a couple more boundaries. All of a sudden, you look up and he's made 25 or 30. More runs there. One thing about these two cricketers, Bishop and Ambrose, is they're never beaten. They always reckon until the final one goes down that they can save the game or even have a little dash at winning it. And here are some runs. In fact, 3 of them. Watch where it lands.
Well, this ball gets tangled up in the body and just nearly drags it onto the stumps.
Dominic Cork's 6 wickets, Kirtley Ambrose, Pepper Ambrose in very similar fashion to his dismissal in the first innings, lobs an easy catch to cover. He's gone for 11, West Indies are 9 down.
Foot's forward a little bit, but the weight is on the back foot, he's not really over the top of the ball.
So England now 1 wicket away from that victory they so earnestly seek. Dominic Cork has his 6th. And Courtney Walsh is the last man in for the West Indies.
Coming up Cork, ball really well. He's bustled in, been aggressive. Hung the ball a little bit, seamed it. He's not only had a good day getting 6 wickets, but he's earned them. Ball really aggressively well. Been talking for a long time of England about getting an all-rounder. He made a few runs.
Test match handsomely, and Dominic Cork has taken 7 wickets on his debut in Test cricket. Michael Atherton has done a terrific job. His captaincy in the first innings, I thought, was really good. In the second, top class, he kept the pressure on. Dominic Cork, 50 runs in the Test match and 7 wickets. First time he's played Test cricket. A magnificent performance.
Well, that was a brilliant performance from England. 223 all out the West Indies. It was in the middle order and towards the end they fell away, although they came back a bit with Gibson, Bishop and Ambrose, but it was much too late. At the top of the order, Sherwin Campbell can be very proud of his performance. That was a great innings, 93 at Lord's, and he had West Indies at one stage on target for a win. Lara 54 and then Jimmy Adams 13. Richardson a duck was the crucial moment for the West Indies. The bowling for England, dominated by Cork, 19.3 overs, 5 maidens, 7 for 43. I thought Gough bowled pretty well, 3 for 79 in 20 overs. Bowled within himself all the time, and those two bowlers took all the wickets. So the match for England, they won by 72 runs. The series is 1-all. Man of the match, Dominic Cork. But there were a lot of heroes in this game for both England and the West Indies. 283 and 336, and West Indies 324 and 223 all out. Cork 7 for 43. And after the festivities began, David Gower talked first of all with Michael Atherton.
Mike, many congratulations. At the start of the day, it looked very evenly poised with 228 still needed to win, 9 wickets still to fall. How are your plans looking then?
I thought we were marginal favourites. The people overnight didn't seem to think so, but, you know, wearing wicket and the pressure's on, we had runs on the board. So I felt we were in an advantageous position and we needed maybe 2 wickets in the first hour, which we got.
Were you at all concerned that the way that, to say, Brian Lara had played the night before, he looked intent on really winning the match by tea time?
We didn't bowl badly. He's the type of player that if he stays in, he scores at a rate. And you just have to accept that both as a captain and as a field inside, and it was important we got to him. And Stewie took a quite magnificent catch.
Yeah, he's done very well, hasn't he? All this controversy about Alex Stewart in the keeper's role. He actually does keep very well, doesn't he?
He does, particularly standing back. He dropped an easier one off Junior Murray, but that was his only blemish in the match. And, you know, that catch off Lara was probably the match-winning catch for us.
Now, your bowlers stuck to their task manfully throughout. Dominic Cork, not a bad debut for him.
Had a fantastic match. He's an aggressive cricketer, and it's good to see he brought his aggression to the Test match arena. You know, bowled kind of nippy outswing and deserved his rewards.
It seems also that if you put pressure on players, sometimes it works. Robin Smith coming into this Test match. One or two rumours, I suggest, nothing more than that in the press, suggesting that it might have been his last if he hadn't succeeded. Very good performance by him too.
We didn't unduly put the pressure on him. We just suggested that as a player with 45, 50 tests under his belt, you know, he ought to be shoring up our middle order. And, we've brought him back down into the middle order this game, and he played 2 magnificent innings.
Yeah, well, congratulations. Look forward to the rest of the series. Now looking at a close contest. Richie, after that success at Headingley, where everything went your way, it's been a hard battle here, hasn't it?
Well, yeah, it's we got to start all over again. We had a very good start, but we didn't play all that well in this test match. England batted very, very well the second innings and gave us 290 runs to win. And it's always going to be very difficult to get that many runs in the last day, especially in this wicket.
Because he'd done well through the first innings of the match, kept England down to what looked a below par total, managed to ease past yourself. How much of a worry was the pitch? Because by and large, it seemed to play, actually seemed to last pretty well through the 5 days.
Yeah, at the start of the match it looked very, very dry. There were some large, very large cracks, and for some reason we didn't think that it would last all 5 days, but it played very well, apart from maybe the second day, and it just played quite well. I think you just had to apply yourselves and occupy the crease.
But did you agree with your manager's comments, Andy Roberts, when he came out halfway through the test match, suggesting that perhaps the pitch had been prepared with England rather more in mind?
Well, I don't know exactly what he said. I mean, you read all sorts of things in the newspaper. The thing is, I heard that the groundsman was accused of leaving the wicket too damp early on in the season, so he tried to take out some of the moisture, and this is what happened. I'm not really criticising the wicket. I've played in a lot worse wicket than that one.
Now, the contest at 1-1 after 2, a lot of cricket still to be played. How do you see this series developing?
I still feel that we've got a very good chance. We beat England convincingly in the first test, and we had a very good chance here. 4 test matches left, and I believe we have a very good chance.
Well, it was a very good test match, as indeed both captains said. And here's the hero of the day for England, Dominic Cork, with David Gower.
Dominic, congratulations. First test match, a match-winning performance. It's fairytale stuff, isn't it?
Yeah, you know, I was so happy to be in the side on Thursday morning, and, it's all gone right. But, it's a team effort. We've all done well out there, and I'm just, so happy to be involved in a test match win at Lord's.
You say it's a team effort. I assume that from the moment you walked into that dressing room, people started to make you welcome.
Yeah, I felt welcome all the way through from the one days and even into this test match as well. And, it's a great spirit in there. And I think, we can go on from here and prove we're a good force in cricket.
First test match. We've had a lot of experience for Derbyshire, firstly, of course, where you've been taking wickets this season. Also on tour this winter with England A. How much of a preparation is an England A tour? It was India and Bangladesh this winter for the real thing, for test cricket itself.
Yeah, India is quite a hard place to tour, as you know. You've got to suffer with medical problems and everything out there. And it seemed to teach me, in particular, I had to be patient in the middle and really adapt to test cricket. 5-day cricket out there was really hard, hot conditions and, good players. So, yeah, out of all the tours, India was probably the best for me.
Would you agree with the system of bringing players through that sort of of preparation?
Yeah, I think so. You know, it's good. It's good to get away with an England team. You know, you're used to touring, you're used to fighting for your position to get into the test side. And, you know, it was good.
Now, playing in India is one thing against England's A team. Did you have any qualms about coming into a full test side against what is still one of the strongest sides in the world?
Yeah, you know, I was a little bit nervous when I first went out there, you know, but I said to myself, I'm good enough to be here, I've been chosen, you know, I've done well this season with the ball. You know, I went out there and just tried to prove that, you know, I'm good enough to play test level.
You looked to enjoy yourself with the bat as well, it wasn't just the ball.
Yeah, I decided, you know, I'm going to guts it out, you know, I'm going to show these people I can bat, you know, I want to make runs at test level and hopefully, you know, I can push on from here and prove I can.
And then bowling bounces at Kirtley Ambrose.
Well, I know that, you know, Kirtley's going to bowl some at me, same as Courtney and Ian Bishop too. So, you know, you've got to give them back what they give you.
Raymond Illingworth doesn't say much, but I should think he is a very, very happy man in the light of all the publicity pre-match here. Here he is with David Gower.
Ray, a lot of controversy before the game started about the selection, sending the keeper home. It all seems to work out pretty well in the end.
Yeah, I think the boys have answered it for me. They've done the business out there. A lot of people are talking about you've got to make 500, bowl them out twice with four bowlers. What I said we've got to do, we've got to win hard-fought, tight test matches. We've done that in this one. It's been a great test match, and the boys have done absolutely everything. Wonderful.
I was talking to Mike Allison earlier, and he agreed that Alex Stewart actually as a keeper is as good as you'll get.
I think that's right. I mean, that catch he took left-handed this morning was a super catch. I don't think anybody could have bettered that. And I think Alec quite likes doing the job really deep down.
I think he did it very well, actually. One or two players didn't have great games. Is that going to cause a problem for you?
Well, we've got to sit down and think about these things. We know that against the West Indians, we can't carry players who are not doing the business, but we want to be trying to be loyal to everybody. What you've got to work out is if people are not doing too well, is it better to give them a couple of games in a county, get back into form again, then give them a chance of coming back, or keep playing them, which is pretty high-pressure stuff, and will they come back to form in the test? It's hard work, is it?
It is hard work. We saw one or two come back into form properly in this test match. Robin Smith played very well, didn't he?
Yeah, and he got 100 or so in the county game as well, which got him going as well. We know Robin's a good competitor, and he'll always fight very hard. I'm glad for him he's come back. What I said to him early on was, look, all the way through his career, I think people have said, you've got to pat him on the back, say you're going to play five and six test matches, but he's done 50 now. We said, you've got to stand up to it. And Robin agrees with me. And you've seen what he's done today. So it may have done him some good that he's a harder character now.
And it wasn't all Dominic Cook, was it, either, with the ball? Dominic got the wickets, bowled very well indeed. Yeah. But it was a good team performance in the field, wasn't it?
Well, I think so. And everybody kept it tight. We bowled much better than Headingley. We didn't give them so many to score off. It's been a good wicket, I think, what everybody says. It's been a good test match. I mean, I would rather watch a match like that than the one where sides get 500, 600. I've really enjoyed it, and everybody's bowled well, and just about everybody's got a few runs, chipped in with a few.
So you're hopeful for a good outcome for the rest of the series?
Well, we didn't want to go two down here, that was for certain. It's set the sails alight now, and I don't think I'll have any trouble selling tickets.
David Gower and Raymond Illingworth there, the England chairman of selectors, certainly was a very happy man. Now, with his ideas on the match and what might be happening in the future, here's Geoffrey Boycott.
Making 296 to win was always going to be a tough task for the West Indies. Once Lara got out early, well, it knocked the stuffing out of them. I thought young Campbell played the best innings he's ever played for West Indies. He was compact, he was sound and sensible, and I think that will do him a good stead for a long career as a West Indies opener. For England, it was Gough, Fraser and particularly Cork who put the West Indies batsmen under pressure. Bowling aggressively, Cork thoroughly deserved his wickets, and that will stand him in good stead for the next test match as well. The pitch, well, Andy Roberts will rule the day. He mentioned about this pitch being poor and underprepared. My advice is, next time, as West Indies manager, it'd be better to wait till the end of the game before he makes any comments at all. And England, well, they will rightly be celebrating a magnificent victory tonight. And they will be thinking, test match next week, Edgbaston, roll on. Same team, same victory.
Thank you, Geoffrey. Geoffrey Boycott with his ideas on this match, and a very good match it was. Just one last word about the pitch, which came under some criticism in various quarters. I would always prefer to see a match like this one, where you had a capacity crowd on the first 4 days. They saw exciting cricket, brilliant stuff at times. As I mentioned earlier, lots of heroes, and 1,166 runs made in the match for the loss of 40 wickets. I'd prefer to see that rather than some side making 600 or 650 and the game finishing in a dull draw. So as far as I'm concerned, the groundsman here at Lord's gets plenty of accolades. Cricket coming up, This is what we have in the future for you. The third Cornhill Insurance Test match on Thursday, the 6th of July, to Tuesday, the 11th, England against West Indies. The series is one all, live coverage on BBC TV all the way through. For the moment, from Lord's, after one of the best test matches I've seen in years, it's goodbye.
Sharing the fruit.